So thank you all very much for coming on such a frosty morning. Linda and I are going to talk about completely different things today. But we thought it would be quite nice if we did one together. I've got a mixture of things to talk about, a little bit of a story, a little bit of what some of you already know that we do, and one or two things that are really quite interesting and controversial that we're planning to do. So this is a book of my father's. He was a GP, and like lots of GPs at the time, he was interested in all aspects of medicine. He used to go to the hospital and actually attend to be a sort of medical attendant as well as doing general practice. And inside that book, there's a chapter written by Hubert Harry Grayson Eastcott about the surgical aspects of medicine, pointing out in almost exactly the same way as we do today that about 20% of strokes are due to thrombosis of the cervical portion of the internal carotid. Not quite exactly the same wording, but also pointing out that many patients have relatively normal intracranial vessels, which at that time was something that had only recently been discovered. People had thought in the past that it was only the intracranial vessels that were the source of the strokes. Felix also put in his chapter that in 1954, the writer and his colleagues reported the first successful arterial reconstruction for internal carotid occlusion, which wasn't completely true, but it was certainly the first report of it. And these are the pictures that went with the report. And of course, they're black and white, and they are rather old, but this is where the patient was, not on an operating table. She'd had 33 episodes of right hemiparesis, aphasia, and left amaurosis cujax over a period of 5 months' time, and had a severe stenosis of the left carotid, and of course they'd had to do an angiogram to find that out at the time. And then this picture here shows Felix actually doing the operation, and Charles Robb, who was his chief, standing in the background, and the patient is in here in an ice bath, because that was the way they decided to cool the patient's brain down, or the whole body in fact at the time, to 28 degrees centigrade with ice baths. And at that time, at the beginnings of cardiac surgery after that, exactly the same methods were used as well. So things have come an awfully long way from there. And the carotid at that time was occluded for 28 minutes. The patient was fine. She lived for many years afterwards. And only died relatively recently, in fact. This is the sort of specimen you get from a carotid endarterectomy. It's a bit disgusting. It's a bit like those advertisements about not smoking, because this is what you take out. That's not the actual carotid. Yes, certainly. Do you want to dim the lights a little bit? At the back? Hello? I can do it from here. Okay.
I don't know what it is.
Okay, thanks. That's great. And again, at around about the same time as my father owned that textbook, this is a Belfast surgeon who wrote about, who wrote about stroke. And he pointed out that the operation is essentially prophylactic and will almost always stop recurring symptoms. So in the 1960s, it began to gain real popularity. And this stylized diagram is quite useful for those who don't know very much about ischemic stroke and the possible sources of emboli to the brain from atheroma, because that is the main process that we're actually talking about here. And nobody knows exactly what percentage are caused by carotid stenosis, but somewhere between 10 and 20%. A lot of trials then took place in the 1980s, between 1980 and 1995. And they were run by neurologists to see whether or not this operation that surgeons clearly enjoyed doing was actually going to be done on the basis of evidence or just done because surgeons actually liked doing it. And two of those trials, one called NASIT and one called ECST, reported simultaneously in 1991 a very significant reduction for the long-term stroke rate, despite the fact that the operation caused some strokes. And the improvement was quite, it was extremely effective because the two trials reported at the same time, and it changed carotid surgery almost forever. And over the period of 40 years then, those first trials in the 1980s changed things and showed that carotid endarterectomy was efficient. In the 1990s, we also did a trial called ACST1 with over 3,000 patients in it, which showed a reduction in stroke over the next 10 years, which was a result of actually doing an operation to remove the atheroma in patients who hadn't had recent symptoms within the previous 6 months. And then attention turned to the less invasive method. So unlike less invasive methods in aortic surgery, less invasive methods in carotid surgery of putting stents in there are not very popular with surgeons because they don't actually do them. They're done in this country by neuroradiologists and some interventional radiologists and one or two other people. But the first set of trials that were done looking at endarterectomy versus stenting as a way of trying to prevent stroke after symptoms were fairly equivocal. To start off with, they showed that there were more strokes in people who'd had stenting. And I suppose surgeons went, well, that's not very surprising. You're sticking something up through a horrible piece of atheroma. It's not surprising. You knock something off and the blood flow carries it up to the brain. So the mechanism by which these minor strokes rather than major strokes were causing the excess of strokes in these patients was really thought to be embolic from actually manipulating not only the arch of the aorta, but also the lesion itself. So what was happening during this long period then from the 1950s, 1960s up to 2010 was that men and women in the UK in middle age, we call it now, although in those days people might have called it old age, between the ages of 65 and 74, the men and women were both having a considerable improvement in the course of death in terms of vascular mortality. The death rate per 100,000 went down from 20 to 30, right down to 5 to 10. And cerebrovascular disease and strokes also went down. And aortic aneurysm, you'd think nobody actually got it if you looked at this. It really wasn't one of the major causes of it there, even though it was causing about 6,000 deaths a year. But generally, there was a big improvement in deaths from vascular disease. Of course, if you go up to the 75-plus age groups, many people are still dying of these things. And one of the causes of these improvements was the recognition that smoking was awfully bad for you, principally in doctors who did the Doctors in Smoking study, which was run from Oxford, over a really long period of time. And the very, 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 very final report on that is due out this year, and that will be the 60th anniversary of it. Believe it or not, about 1,000 of the doctors that took part in that study were still alive at the time that this 60th anniversary report was actually being prepared. That is due out this year. The smoking has decreased enormously, but here you see the risk of having severe carotid artery stenosis related to the current smokers versus never smokers, and it's about 4 or 5 times greater. So those are the people that we often see in vascular surgery, and the number of people smoking in the country has now dipped below 20% just, but we still have a lot of people who smoke and come to see us. And it is rather bad for your brain, not just in terms of having stroke, but it causes, we think, vascular dementia. Now, that has yet to be proven, and that's the part of the controversy about what I'm going to say in a few minutes. So stroke is still the third commonest cause of death, greatest cause of disability in the UK, but does it also contribute significantly vascular disease to dementia? A lot of patients find it very difficult to stop smoking. They certainly find it difficult to take their drugs regularly. And of course, physicians believe that when they prescribe the drugs, the patients will take it forever and that will solve the problem. But many of our patients don't bother to take them. However, in favour of intervention, once you've had the intervention, you can't take it away. So compliance is 100%. And if you're going to prevent something, it's probably better to prevent it as a one-off thing for some people if they prefer to take the upfront risk. So to come back again, why operate if stenting works as well as surgery? Well, it was apparently not as well as surgery when they first did trials looking at symptomatic patients. But the longer term results were very important, and those then came out last year, and you can see this is the modified ranking scale, which is a measure of disability, and in people who've had symptoms of stroke beforehand, they generally were supposed to have a modified ranking score between 0, 1 and 2 before they entered this study. 3, 4, 5 were very disabled and 6 was dead, more or less. At the follow-up after 4 years, you could see that between those that had stenting and those that had surgery, there wasn't any difference in the modified ranking scale between the two groups, despite the excess of minor strokes at the beginning. So in general, both in surgery and stenting, over a period of time, the left is surgery, the right is stenting, the hazards of both have been coming down in trials and in registries. The reason for the reduction in surgery, apart from the fact that surgery is done well, is certainly partly to do with the fact that most of the patients who are having prophylactic surgery or who are known to have vascular disease are on statins. But there's certainly a reduction in procedural risks being seen now for stenting. And our current trial compares surgery or stenting in people who either have never had symptoms or haven't had recent symptoms. Probably about half of the patients have had some form of symptom which has brought it to their attention to have a scan, and quite a lot of them have had the other side operated on. It's a very, very European trial. Actually, this is the Vatican flag, and we don't yet have patients from there, but we do have the surgeon in the trial who is the vascular surgeon to the Vatican, so you never know if any cardinal has developed this, or we might see something there yet. As of today, we've got 2,054 patients in the trial. Our target is 3,600. This is a sort of true rate of recruitment. So we are on target to reach that by the end of 2019, which is what we hope to do. And what is very interesting is what's been happening during the trial. So the techniques and the devices and the experience have all been changing since that first symptomatic trial I showed you the result of. And now, instead of going up through a lesion and knocking bits off, they first started using umbrella-like filters to catch things, but those actually obviously had to be put through the lesion first of all. But now they have got very, very clever flow reversal systems, so they can actually prevent embolization. They've got filters as well. They've got a recognition that if you put in stents with very wide gaps between the struts, that you're more likely to have atheroma actually going through that and causing embolization. And also direct puncture, avoiding the aortic arch, is becoming more popular. In particular, there is now a system that's been CE marked that could be a system for surgeons. It's been taken up by a lot of people in Europe who are surgeons, and it goes by the name of Road Saver or something similar to that, and they actually reverse the flow and go in through the neck through a mini incision in the neck directly into the carotid. It probably will be quicker than actual open-end arterectomy, and the question is, will it be more effective? Well, we still have 4 more years to look at this, and if I show you, these are the stenting devices used in the first 800 or 900 patients in order of the sort of frequency. So these green ones here, these green protection devices, are the newest devices, and this one here is a flow reversal protection device. So gradually, in the next 4 years, we might in fact incorporate a lot of the newer technology. We certainly hope so. Road Saver is just coming in here, and several other devices are coming as well. So it might well be that in 4 years' time, things have changed considerably. Currently, at 1,500 patients, and we'll report again later this year to our data monitoring committee, we have a lower disabling and fatal stroke rate of fatal MI, 30-day hazard rate from the procedure than we had in that first trial for endarterectomy, which was 1.7%. And despite the fact that the patients coming in and are older they have more risk factors rather than smoking, we have actually got a lower serious procedural risk. So it seems to be that the two procedures together are certainly reasonably effective. We have to see what the long-term effectiveness is in stroke prevention. And that brings me to the last question, really, which sounds a bit rapid, don't worry. this one's a little bit longer. And it's the intriguing question of whether carotid surgery can actually prevent dementia or indeed stenting. And Richard Bobulia, who's a surgeon from Cheltenham, who a lot of people know here, and he also works across the road in the population health department, he and I are very interested in this. It's a really big problem. Everybody knows this. The prevalence in the UK is going up and up and up, and is estimated to be nearly 2 million by the year 2050. So that's going to be a considerable problem. It's also extremely expensive. The cost this last year, about 23 billion, and in only by 2040 that could be up to 70 billion. So it is a considerable problem. This is one of the uses of big data to actually see what these things do. Now, cognitive aging can be measured, and if you put together large studies like the lipid lowering studies, HPS, SIRT, and THRIVE, and you look at the effect, you will find that although things like diabetes and so on have some effect on cognitive aging, the two processes that have the greatest effect by far are stroke and transient ischemic attack. So it is logical to assume that there might well be some relationship between carotid stenosis and vascular dementia. There are other studies that have looked at this as well, and the Rotterdam study invited everyone over the age of 55 in the town of Omroed, you have to correct me if I've got it wrong, and 75% of them participated. So they had cognitive testing and a detailed assessment and a carotid duplex scan. And it was very clear that there's a threefold excess risk of vascular dementia associated with the presence of carotid plaque. If you look at the peripheral vascular disease, carotid plaque, the wall thickness, and a scoring system for atherosclerosis, you see here vascular dementia. Not very many people in it, but it's certainly a strong suggestion that carotid plaque is associated with dementia. Very wide confidence intervals. Another study, which is very well known, during the 1990s and which is ongoing now, is the cardiovascular health study from the United States. And a subset of these people who are Medicare beneficiaries had this particular test done. So cognitive impairment with a mini mental score was associated with high-grade left internal carotid artery stenosis. And since most people are left hemisphere dominant, you might expect that the left hemisphere would have more to do with the diagnostic accuracy of looking at people with vascular dementia. And there was a very clear relationship between the degree of stenosis and the mini mental score in these people. So they said categorically that cognitive impairment and decline are associated with this. So, of course, the question is, can drugs prevent it? Well, actually, quite surprisingly, no trials of aspirin or statins have demonstrated any protective effect against cognitive decline or dementia. If you assess it in a lot of patients who are in the VHF heart protection study, that's 20,000 patients who were randomized between simvastatin or placebo over 4 years, that's quite a long time ago, then again you find that a score of under 22 or 39, which is indicative of severe cognitive impairment, is much the same in both of the groups. You can see there's no age relationship other than the fact that as they get older, cognitive impairments get gets greater, but there is certainly no difference between those who have been taking 40 milligrams of simvastatin for a long time and those who are taking placebo. A so-called systematic review of 28 trials, which obviously didn't include an awful lot of people since some of them included only 6 patients, suggested that maybe endarterectomy might be protective in 16 out of 28 of those, or harmful in those. So not a lot of helpful evidence from that. But then here, looking at cognitive tests before and 3 to 6 months afterwards, there was a suggestion from Lau that revascularization was associated with improved cognitive function. But this is not vascular dementia. This is a short-term measure of cognitive function. It certainly suggests that it's not harmful. So the question is still there, can carotid surgery or stenting prevent dementia? And you really need very, very much more large observational studies to do this, or a very specific trial. So China Kaduri Biobank, which is run from Oxford as well, has 500,000 participants from 10 localities in China, aged between 30 and 79. And these people fill out a questionnaire, quite a long questionnaire. They give some blood for long-term storage, and 25,000 of them also had a carotid scan. It is also linked as well, since it's in the same building, to the findings that are coming out now from the UK Biobank, and some of the people here may even have been invited to be part of the UK Biobank. So there's another 500,000 people recruited in Wales, Scotland and England. Again, lifestyle, environmental factors, and a longish questionnaire, but quite a clever kind of assessment took them through very extensive tests, including cognitive function. And they all consented to have their electronic records made available, and some of us are actually now able to go into some of those to look for information. But 100,000 of them are going to have carotid imaging. So in China Kaduri Biobank, the numbers of first events, and this is a relatively short period of time, show stroke, a lot more strokes than they've actually expected, along with 24,000 cases of ischemic heart disease. So that's 60,000 cases in a relatively short period of time out of 500,000 people. If you look at the number of incident outcomes expected from UK Biobank and look at dementia specifically, because in 2012 they had 1,000 cases, 2017 they think it's right there, and by 2022 they will have 9,000 cases, as many as they have strokes. So there will be quite a lot of cases to look at. The type of imaging they're using is different from what we use in the lab, so they're doing 3D imaging. And they've increased that number to 125,000 participants to look at total plaque volume, carotid intermedia thickness, and wall volume. And they should have accurate and hopefully rather less subjective imaging of that, or subjective assessments of this to follow up. Just by the way, one of the other carotid trials, which is again comparing medical management with surgery or medical management with stenting, has just started in the United States, and they have just a small number of participants, but they are going to do cognitive testing in quite a large subset of these patients as well, and follow them for quite a long time. So back to the original question, can carotid intervention prevent dementia? Well, you need randomized evidence. That trial I've just shown you, CREP2, will do cognitive assessment at baseline and final follow-up, but they'll have to go for quite a long period of time. For, you know, 6 months isn't going to be helpful. They're going to need really long follow-up. We happen to have really long follow-up from the first trial where we compared intervention with surgery with medical treatment alone. And it is possible to follow up 1,600 of those patients. There's about 1,069 from the UK and 532 from Sweden. And the Swedes are brilliant. They can link anything to anything. They will know at the drop of a hat whether people have developed dementia, whether they're in nursing homes, and whether they actually have these sorts of things, we do have the electronic linkage. It just takes a little longer to get all the permissions to look at that. But we hope that it will be possible within the next year to actually look at the proportion of people in the first trial who had endarterectomy and compare them with those who didn't. And this could prove extremely interesting because it is a randomized trial and most of the people who were randomized to receive surgery actually had it. The total follow-up in the trial for people is now between 11 and 22 years. So it will be a uniquely long follow-up in people who averaged about 68 years when they first entered the trial. So we should be looking at people in their late 70s and early 80s, and that will be interesting. It may not show anything, but it might just show, and I think Richard's probably a bit more confident than I am, that carotid surgery or stenting might well prevent dementia or be one of the possible aids to doing so, because at the moment certainly drugs don't seem to be able to do so. Thank you.
So, it's the Integrated Care Platform Project. It's a telemedicine project under the auspices of the Oxford Telemedicine Institute, which sits within the NDS. And the principle behind this project is that we want to try and reduce the number of attendances, particularly in outpatients, but also for investigations in the John Radcliffe and the Churchill Hospital, by moving investigations to the community and then combining those investigations with video conferencing or video consultation between the patient as in the GP practice and an OUH clinician. And we can also follow up the patient by video consultation. So we don't change the treatment, we don't change necessarily where the treatment is done, but we change the things around that in an effort really to reduce patient travel, but also to make the whole system rather more efficient if we can. So we're starting with leg ulcers, and we're taking patients with any ulcer below the knee. Most of those will be venous, quite a few will be arterial, and some will be neuropathic. And these are patients who would normally be referred to vascular surgery, dermatology, or diabetic podiatry. So we're not changing the patients who are being referred or who's seeing them, but we're just changing their pathway. And at the moment, at least, we're excluding urgent cases. So if they need to be seen and assessed within 2 weeks, then this isn't the pathway for them, at least at the moment. And what we've set up is a protocol whereby the decision as to which investigations are done is determined by this protocol, and we're sending out trained technologists who normally work in our vascular laboratory and our other vascular laboratories with portable duplex equipment, which is what we frequently use in the hospital as well, to assess those patients prior to video consultation. So that's just to give you an idea of what we do before the video consultation. We've got platforms set up at those five sites in Oxfordshire, and on the right hand side are the clinicians involved. And I've run a vascular clinic by video consultation for many years, and for vascular surgery it's reasonably straightforward if you've got a nurse at the other end who's used to it. To talk to a vascular patient, asking the sort of focus questions that a GP might not ask, but a vascular surgeon would, and to look at the ulcer, to assess the limb itself, for the person at the other end, the nurse usually, to lift the leg up and look at the colour, to listen to the doctor signal over it. But in addition to all of that, we'll have the duplex scan, of the arteries or the veins or whatever is relevant there. And what we heard is that from that information, at that single video consultation, that we can make a decision on treatment. Now, it may not be possible, but that's what the research is about. Is it possible to come to a decision at that video consultation? The patient can then have their treatment as normal, and then any follow-up can also be done via the same platform. So, at the moment, the advantages we see of the ICP are that it reduces travel for patients, of course, and sometimes some of our patients come up to be seen initially as a new patient in clinic. They then come up again for a scan in the vascular laboratory, and then they come up again for a consultation to discuss what we might do. And these are, for us, fairly elderly patients who may not have social support, who can't really remember what sort of dressings they've had, and after we've spoken to them, they may not remember what we said. But if the video consultation is done with the nurse who's normally looking after them, the practice nurse or the district nurse, which is part of this project, we hope to involve them, then not only can they tell us what sort of dressings they've had and what sort of problems which the patient may not recall, but afterwards they're seeing the patient on a regular basis and can remind them what was discussed in the consultation. And they have a ready link to us if there's any concerns, and we can do another video consultation if we need to take another look at the patient or the ulcer. So by doing this, we hope we also enhance skills in the community itself. We keep the community clinicians involved in patient care. They're not shifted off to the hospital, it all goes on there, and then they come back as a package at the end. It's an integrated system all the way along. And we hope to reduce the workload in hospital. I hope it also improves the parking in the hospital, but we'd have to see about that. So what we've got is the three sites in Oxford, in dermatology, oxygen therapy and vascular surgery, linking to practices in Bicester, Woodstock, Wantage, Didcot and Henley. And that covers a population of about 120,000, so it's about 20% of the Oxfordshire population. It's skewed a little to take more of those over 65, because we wanted those for the leg ulcers. But those platforms are in place in the practices. They're going into dermatology and to Octem over the next few weeks. We've got some training to do. And we've also got agreement from the commissioners to fund the first 100 patients through this pathway. So we can send out technologists to vascular scientists to the community to do the scanning. And we're going to compare those patients with those coming through conventional outpatient pathway. But the reason for bringing this to the grand round is not to talk so much about leg ulcers, but to say this is out there. We will be using it for part of the week for leg ulcer patients, but there's plenty of space on it to look at other projects, and we're really keen to do pilot projects in other areas. Essentially, I think looking at a set of symptoms the patient might present to the GP and symptoms which we see a lot of referred up to hospital. So it's no good going for a niche area, but common symptoms, commonly patients coming up with those symptoms, often having to be seen and investigated in the hospital. And thinking, can we move those investigations in some way to the community so that we can answer the questions we need to make the decision on treatment in a one-stop video consultation? So, varicose veins would be an obvious one to go for. We do still have quite a few patients sent up, not necessarily with leg ulcers, but with symptomatic varicose veins, which may need treatment. David and I and others have spoken about lower urinary tract symptom patients, shortness of breath, palpitations. The geriatricians are keen to try it out for assessing their elderly patients. And there may well be other uses for this, which I haven't thought of, but I'd be very keen to discuss the other options with you if you think there may be an opening here. So it's out there, it's ready to go, and we're keen to look for other pilot projects for it. Thank you. Any questions?
From hub and spoke
hospitals. Yes, we're working on that as well. This is a fixed setup in a GP practice where other practices close by can also send their patients. If you're going for a hospital system, because patients are scattered all over the place, you have to decide whether you're doing a focused study on stroke patients, for example, or whether you're going to use it more generally. We've just been in discussion about setting up telemedicine for stroke in Milton Keynes, for example. And that's using a small portable setup. But the more portable it is, the more likely it is to walk out of the hospital as well, which is part of the problem with it. So it needs to be easily accessible at the referring hospital end, but it also needs to be easily accessible at this end and as by VPN at home if we're going to use it round the clock. So consultants need to be able to see patients while the consultants are at home and decide whether they need to come to Oxford or not. So there are a number of issues around that, and that to a certain extent dictates whether you use a focus setup that's just the stroke or whether you make it more portable over the whole hospital so it's more widespread use.
I was thinking particularly of diabetic
seats. Yes. No, well, this is the first step in assessing diabetic seat. And once we've got it off the ground through vascular surgery largely and also through Opden, then I think we can roll it out at hospital level. Tim. Still rolling on, yes. Yes. Well, yes. Well, the imaging on the during the video consultation is much better than it used to be. It's really good. We used to send digital photographs to back up the video consultation, but actually I'm not sure they're necessary any longer because it really is good. But what we're also introducing through this is a computerized photography project whereby you can generate a 3D model of the ulcer as well and follow its progress in healing, but also potentially look at other areas around that. We may be able to use it for diagnostic methods if we can get the colour right, because in vascular surgery the colour is really important. So we're working on Yes. So the advantage of this computerised system is that it standardises the colour. It doesn't matter what the ambient lighting is, you get a standardised, reproducible photograph. Okay. Well, come to me if you've got any ideas. Thank you, everyone.